I'm Ron Gelderman, extension soil specialist for the state, and Corey Smith is going to help me here. He's our research technician, and we're just going to spend a few minutes talking about plant sampling, plant analysis. A lot of folks are doing plant analysis these days. They're just taking plants, monitoring it during the season, what those nutrient levels are in those fields. And really, you can see we've got two types of plant analysis. One we call diagnostic. We see a problem out in the field, we sample a good area and a poor area, the same plant part at the same time. And then we've got our check there. That good area is our check. Everything's been done the same on that plant as a poor area. And then plant analysis becomes a real powerful tool to determine if nutrients are that problem that's causing that symptom. And so, but then the other type is just monitoring, going out in the field every so many weeks and taking a plant. There we need very good interpretive data. In other words, very good averages of in the book values, and that's what we use to compare it. Is this low? Is this sufficient? Or where does it fall? So we need some good book values there. And we it's been 40 or 50 years since really anybody in the Midwest has really done any plant studies. And so that's what we're going to look at. And that nutrient concentration, it can vary by age. As soon as that plant comes up, it's probably got the highest nitrogen concentration it's going to have, for example. And as the plant ages, it keeps going down and down, that N concentration, because it's just growing so much, it's adding a lot of carbohydrates, diluting that nitrogen down. And so the age makes a difference when you take it. The plant part that you take makes a lot of difference. If you take the leaf up here, pretty high N content, you take it on the bottom, the one that's almost dead, it's already transferred some of that nitrogen out of that leaf. So that makes a difference of where you take that. Variety can have some effect as well. And that's why we really need good averages, a lot of different samples from a lot of different fields to see what that average should be. Environmental conditions can have effect as well. And so, it's been 40, 50 years, like I said before, since our interpretations that we're using now, so they're quite different, or could be quite different, and that's one thing we're going to look at with soybean. Well, let's start off with soybean here, just to show you the plant sample that we want. We want to take that at early bloom. I think I've got one here. And you just look at the plant. If you see a bloom on there, that's when they suggest taking a plant sample to monitor those nutrient contents. If it's got a pod already on the top four nodes, it's getting too late. You're already transferring nutrients out of that leaf. And so that's when we want to take it, early bloom, full bloom, just so it doesn't have a pod. What leaf do you want? We really want one of the top leaves that's already fully developed. Usually the third leaf down. You can see this is the first leaf here is pretty small. This one here is getting there too. This is the second one. That's getting there, and this is the third one that's pretty much fully developed. And so usually the third one, that's usually one of the highest ones on the plant, and so you can just go down and take 25, 30 of those in the field or area you want sampled, and that'll be your sample. And all we want is a trifoliate. We don't want the petiole here. And there's some data on this sheet that shows that if you put this petiole in with the trifoliate, you can dilute some nutrients, you can actually increase others. And so we're just looking at the trifoliate there. So it's pretty critical that you get the right part at the right time. For corn, and that's really the only time we've got good calibration data on soybean, is during the bloom period. For corn, we've actually got three periods that we can use. One is before it's 12 inches tall. We just sample the whole plant, cut it off at the surface, and take that plant. After 12 inches tall, before it's tasseled, we take the top leaf from the whorl that's got the collar showing. And you can see the collar showing right here. And if that would be the one that's showing right underneath the whorl, that's the leaf you'd take. And so we're taking those leaves. Now it's tasseled, that's the third stage that we use. We usually take the leaf opposite and below the primary ear that's starting. And as soon we try to take that at initial silk, when you see half of the stalks at least got silk, and before they get brown, that's when we try to take it. And yeah, it's the leaf opposite and below. And usually a lot of times there's another ear coming there as well. But it's the primary ear we start with and take that sample. And again, 20, 25 plant ears, or leaves, I mean, should do it. And you'll see our current sufficiency level for corn and soybean there on a chart. If you can read it, it's pretty dang small. And plant sampling guidelines, where to take it and how many to take and that sort of thing. And it's got some pictures, plant sampling soybean, but again, we showed those already, and how to take sampling on corn. I'd like Corey to show you some plant sensors. It's kind of a plant analysis too, but more automated. And one is the SPAD meter. I think most of us have seen that. It measures actually chlorophyll, how green that plant is, that leaf, and that's a pretty good correlation with nitrogen. And if you want to show, Corey, we just clamp down on that opposite and below that ear leaf. Okay, I'll hold that. And then we get a reading off of that. And you do that 15, 20 times, and it takes an average and gives you a reading off of that. And if you can compare that to correlation data that you've got that shows that, we should be fertilizing or this plant is low in nitrogen. And we're doing a bunch of these end studies on corn this year for the next 2-3 years. And we're going to be using that that is one of the sensors to indicate if we need to side dress. And so the other sensor we have here is an iPad or an iPhone. Has an app you can buy for $100, and it's supposed to do the same thing as a SPAD meter. And so we're going to try that out and see if that works. And so that's $100. This is around $2,600. And so there's quite a difference there. And if they give us the same reading, and we did one, if you want to try that, Corey, you can go ahead. Oh, you need your, yeah. We need a color chart here. And it really, all you do is use a camera on there, and it takes a picture and compares the color to that and calibrates and estimates how green it is.
So the two calibration discs, it'll ask you to point the camera at each of these to calibrate the camera. And then before you first start it, you have to do a white balance, because as you move the camera about, it keeps adjusting the brightness of the image. So we want that to remain constant. So. If you have an iPhone, it's a little handier.
Yeah, that's a little big for the iPad.
So what we would do is hold the leaf in the pink area. And the pink just tells the camera that that's the background, so we can get some of the pink in the image. And I guess if you're interested, you can come up and take a closer look. But so, you just want me to maybe pass it around or?
No, I think that's all right. It's
So what it'll ask you to do first is to tap the green circle on this board. So you tap the green circle, and then it'll ask you to tap the yellow circle. And then it's going to ask you to tap which section of the leaf you want imaged. So the sun's kind of blocking, but so we would want the midsection, so we would tap the midsection of the leaf. And then after that's all done, you hit done, and then it gives you your spat equivalent number. So
how's that compared to what you got off of there?
That's actually, there's a comparison on the handout I gave you. And the SPAD, and this doesn't give exact same, but it's correlated very highly on that particular plot. And so we're going to do a number of plots and see if we can't use this as a less expensive alternative to this. And of course, there's on-the-go sensors like Green Seeker, and we're using one of Shannon's handheld Green Seekers also to look at a greenness of corn and see if we need side dressing at a particular and how much we should add. And so that's kind of like three of the sensors that we're using to try to delay some of that nitrogen application and predict better of how much we need later in the season. So that's some of the things that we're doing. But
are you able to tie that into grids across your whole field?
Yeah, you could do that with grids, management zones. Yeah, you could map out your field. You could input that into the, say, on the go Green Seeker, and really the Green Seeker and this, they're all reading kind of the greenness of the leaf, and that's the key, how green it is. And so yeah, you could input those into a map, and then the Green Seeker you know, how you're going to use that yet, I don't know. You need those equations to figure that out yet, how we're going to use that data. But perhaps some areas of the field have higher nitrate content than other area zones, and so you may want to vary your equation based on that and the readings that you get from the Green Seeker. But scouting or something like this, if you just want to go out and see how it is on your own, it's something that you could utilize these hand tools for. But there are these sensors available. So anything else? Yeah.
Ron, would there be a benefit to couple soil sampling with your plant sampling?
Oh, yes. I'm not ruling out soil sampling at all. I think soil sampling is the first step you do. And from that, you base really your recommendation on there. But then trying to refine that, you probably want to put some of your N on earlier for corn. And then, okay, how much do I want to put on later if I can delay that application? And so I think this is where that use comes, yeah. Yeah. Anything else? Handling the samples, that's a good question. We usually like to dry them down a little bit before you ship them, if shipping is going to be involved for a couple of days. The best part, if you can just bring them right to the lab, but we usually like to dry them down and ship them in paper just so they don't mold. And this time of year, they can mold fairly quickly. We don't want to lose some of that that nitrogen or whatever nutrient it is in there. So